Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living Victoria Online. It's lovely to have you here with us today, and while we still are not back in our physical facilities and we're missing them, it is so good to be able to see all of your faces online. And if you're joining us in a recording, then welcome, 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 and we hope to see you in person one day too when we open up again. Right now, the word is that it will likely be around the middle of February, but we know that things are updated all the time, so we'll keep you posted on that. So this morning, I would like to invite our wonderful Reverend Joanna to give us an opening treatment. Please join us with that.
Unmute. There we are. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So as we enter into this new year, bright with promise, I know that we are held in Spirit's love as we move forward into this time of new beginnings, a time of new relationships, of new opportunities, of new growth, of new openings. As we emerge from this strange year that we have lived through, with the cloud of the pandemic apparent in our lives, I know that God, Spirit, the universal consciousness, is ever present in this time and in this place, present in all time and in all places. God is the source of all, the unifying glory of every visible and invisible element of the universe. And the wonderful truth of this is that each of us is a unique expression of that divine splendor. And in our each and every unique way, we contribute to the fabric of life that is the creative expression of the divine. Our very thoughts, our words, our actions advance the consciousness of spirit in the universe. And so as we look to the bright hope of new beginnings, we look also to this day, to this moment, knowing that we are each divine expressions in human form, and that our lives matter, that as we think, so we manifest. So let us think truth, let us think health, let us think of beautiful futures, knowing that as we think these into form, so they shall become. I give thanks for the power of this teaching, for Reverend Carrie, Reverend Rachel, Reverend Jennifer, Reverend Raymond, and for our wonderful practitioner, Lesia. We give thanks for the power of this teaching that transforms lives. I release my word to spirit, to the law, knowing it is so, and so it is.
Carrie, can you unmute, please?
I didn't realize that I was muted. I was just thinking this week about today being the 17th of January and the third Sunday, and thinking, you know, where did those 17 days go? It seems as if every year the days are passing more quickly. And yet I did remember that January 3rd was also a Sunday, so it's not quite so speeding by at warp speed anyway. But as you know, we go back to basics every year in January. And the first Sunday was the thing itself, which of course is God, the power that is within each one of us. And the second week is how it works. And of course, it works through us. God, source, the power, the intelligence, whatever it is that you want to call it, it's not that old man on a throne somewhere that we may have grown up thinking that it was. But this enormous power is within us, and it needs a vehicle through which it can work. So we are the vehicles. We are the containers of God, the containers of this power. And we get to use it every moment of our lives. The thing is that we often think that it is something that is very difficult to do. You know, this teaching was say it's difficult, it's complicated. You know, there's so much to remember. The thing is that that's not the way that it is at all. The way that it is it's incredibly simple. It's just that we complicate it with our thinking. We tend to overthink things, or we'll think a positive thought, and then we'll think about all the things that could go wrong with that instead of all of the things that can go right. And so this week, as we look at the next part of, or the third chapter of the Science of Mind textbook, what it is or what it does, you know, what does it do? And as we're looking at that, and thinking about it, we need to be thinking about it in a more simplified way. And I'm going to try to get through that in a more simple way today. But Ernest Holmes said that to return to a sane simplicity is one of the first and most important things to do. You know, we have to stop complicating things. We have to stop that negative thought as it's coming up for us. We have to stop saying, can't do it, won't happen to me, you know, good things happen to other people, but I just seem to be low on the totem pole. That's just not the way it is at all. And we have to understand that this power, this force within us that is working, that is creating, is as easy as breathing. As easy as breathing in and breathing out. It's as easy as having our heartbeat. Think about that. We don't have to stop and think about breathing. We don't have to think about beating our hearts. It's just a natural thing. Well, this law is a natural thing as well. The law of cause and effect. And it's as we think, as we believe, it is done unto us. Scripture says, as we believe it is done unto us, or as you believe it is done unto you. And of course, Wayne Dyer said, believing is seeing. When we truly believe something, we will see it manifest in our lives. And that's the good news and the bad news. It means if we're constantly at the core of our being, believing negative things, then we're going to create more of those things in our lives. And, you know, I love the expression Marianne Williamson often quotes from AA, your best thinking got you here. And so when we look around us, when we look at our lives, at everything in it, are we content? Are we happy? Is everything unfolding perfectly in our lives? And we don't have to make it complicated by saying, well, you know, things are not working for me the way I want them to right now. So I don't know if they're ever going to. Instead, we just need to stop it. You know, we've created these stories. We've been programmed from birth. We've created stories about ourselves that have been built by families and friends and teachers and colleagues who are all too willing to share what they think our stories might be. And then they become part of this big story. And so I'm thinking, you know, in the new year, what a good time to just say, put it in the past. I'm going to write a new one. I'm going to write a new script for my life. The movie of my life from this point forward is just be a feel-good movie. It's going to be a feel-good life. Absolutely everything about it. And so what we need to do in order to accomplish this is to train our minds. The thing is that we're manifesting things every minute of our lives according to what our belief system is. If we're not thinking about it, I've said this often, if it simply is random, if we're not thinking about it, then things are being created. And they're being created according to what our deepest belief systems might be. And we're just really not conscious of it. So we need to train our minds. But here's the important thing too. Dr. Holmes said that the trained mind is much more powerful than the untrained mind. And, you know, and I know that for a fact. I mean, I've had experiences in my life where I could certainly see that happen. But he also said, the one who gives conscious power to his thoughts should be more careful what it is that he thinks than the one that does not. And that's a warning. Be more conscious of your thoughts than someone who is not. Because one would think that if you're conscious of your thoughts, that absolutely everything is just going to work out perfectly. If your thoughts are trained, that everything is going to work out perfectly. And it can be so. But the thing is, you know, if people are just kind of going along randomly, not thinking about this at all, life just happens. And, you know, it happens to them, again, according to whatever their belief systems are. But once our thoughts are trained, once we've been in this teaching for a while and have really studied, we start to notice that things happen much more quickly. And the thing is, if we have an untrained mind, we might say something, you know, randomly like, oh, you know, what a terrible day. And it's not going to be a terrible day for us. Once we have a trained mind and we say, oh, what a terrible day, we're going to be creating more of a terrible day. And it's going to happen very, very quickly. And I've had some examples of this in my own life, and I've probably shared them. I know I've shared them in class. I don't know if I've ever shared them when I've been speaking on Sundays. But I was thinking back to the years when I was in studies leading up to being a practitioner and then to being a minister. And when I was in my practitioner studies, I was actually taking other classes as well, three nights a week. And the classes on Mondays, or rather on Tuesdays and Thursdays, were at 7:30 p.m. And on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. And so one night I was going to class, and it was Wednesday night, and I arrived. It was 20 past 7. And I was surprised there were so many cars there, because I was usually the first one there. And there were 15 of us in this class. And then all of a sudden I realized, oh, no, it's Wednesday. I should have been here at 7:30. I should have been here at 7 o'clock, not 7:30. And I grabbed my books and stepped out of the car, and it was a wet, slippery night. And I just said, oh, I slipped up, and I went backward and fell flat on my back, on my head, without any impact at all. I didn't feel any impact. It was like being caught by a cloud. I keep saying an angel must have caught me, because I didn't feel anything. It was just a very peaceful thing. And I got up and I thought, oh my goodness, this is what we teach. You know, as you think, as you speak your word, and there was passion behind it, because I was scolding myself for being late for class. It happened instantly. It was just like that. And I thought, every once in a while, when we really need to understand how quickly this teaching or works when we have a trained mind, then we do have to become much more careful about our thoughts. And having a trained mind is a wonderful thing because we can create so much more. But the thing is, we get it and we lose it, we get it, we lose it. You know, we have to stay conscious. And that's really what it's all about. And as we're practicing this every day, we just become more and more in the habit of always having those positive thoughts and always looking for good in the worst circumstances, looking for a gift in it somewhere. Where can this be doing some good? And the second example that I had was my minister at the time, Darlene Schneider was her name. It's now Darlene Chase. Wonderful woman. She made very little money. It seems to be something that happens with a lot of ministers in this teaching. And I had come from a high-powered job where I made a lot of money. And I was just always, you know, feeling really, really badly that she wasn't making so much money and that people weren't tithing as much as I thought they should. And I was no longer working. I was spending all my time studying. And I was doing some writing, but I, you know, it was for myself. I wasn't working at a job somewhere. And I thought, well, you know, I want to tithe more. And as I was driving home from class one night, I just had this powerful urge within me. And the words that came to me were, I want to tithe $6,000 a year. And it was just, that's it. That's what I want to do now. And the next morning, I had a phone call from a friend of a friend, and she said, we are hiring at the Center for Integrative Healing, and we're wondering if you would be interested in coming in and being our COO. And she said, the job is only 4 days a week, and the pay isn't as high as what you're used to. It's only $60,000 a year, but if you would be interested, we would love to have you. And I said, done, just like that. And I thought, it is so perfect. 10% of $6,000 is, or rather, 10% of $60,000 is $6,000. Overnight, that happened. And I've had experiences like that in my life as well. And so the thing is, as long as we're working at it, and Lassia, you know, you're in class now, and you've been in class now for the last few years, and you know how absolutely powerful it is when you are in it every day. When that's what you're thinking about. I mean, it's just, you just feel that presence of God within all the time. You know that it is there. There's absolutely no question about it. And the mind is being constantly trained and things start to unfold faster and faster and faster. And so I remind myself, if I'm starting to forget these things and I don't really like what's out picturing in my life, I remind myself that it's really time to get back to basics. It is really time for me to be spending more time consciously monitoring my thoughts and knowing that they are positive and knowing that I am creating the highest and best in my life. So it is that simple, or it is that complicated. You know, I don't want to be slipping and falling on my back. You know, even though it was such a gentle thing when it happened then, it was a reminder. It was that demonstration that showed how a negative response to something can affect us. And I don't want those kinds of things happening to me in a negative way, and I don't think that any of you do either. So my topic today is the riddle of simplicity. And as we look at this chapter in the book, what it does, you know, that's the riddle, really. What does it do? And the answer to that question sometimes confuses people, because the answer is quite simply, it loves us. Now, this is not the kind of love that we have for our significant others, for our children, for our dear friends, for colleagues. You know, they're different kinds of love. But this love is pure, unconditional love. And what it is the divine givingness of the universe. That's what Ernest Holmes calls it. He said it is the divine givingness, and it is pure love, He said, love points the way and the law makes it happen. The law, of course, is cause and effect. And so it is whatever is put into mind is created according to our thoughts and beliefs. But we might say, well, how could it be loving if there's war on this planet? How can it be loving if someone is suffering somewhere? How can it be loving if so much of the world right now is infected with a terrible virus? How can it be loving? The thing is that, as I said last week, and I think the week before, is this power is impersonal. And so it's according to what we think. And it's an interesting thing to consider right now as COVID is getting worse and worse, and it's been predicted that it is, how race consciousness grows, how people become more and more afraid of it, how they become more fearful that it's going to get worse. I often stop and think, is that what is making it worse? And whether or not it is, how important it is for us to see the world healthy. How important it is to see everyone healthy. How important it is to see this world at peace. God knows we need to see America at peace today and every day in the coming days. We need to hold that in our conscious minds and not be looking at the ain't it awful, as Reverend Jennifer likes to say. I love that comment, ain't it awful. How many people do we know who, whenever, if we say, how are you? It's like, oh, you have no idea how terrible it is. And then they go on and on. And we do this. I do this when I'm looking at the news, when I'm looking at what is happening right now in the United States. I get into that space of worrying about what it's going to be. And I realized this last week, got to stop that. Got to start seeing peace, got to start seeing economic recovery, got to start seeing people getting well everywhere. Got to see this, and as in the meditation this morning, this spiraling vortex of energy, this spiraling vortex of light pouring down through every human being on this planet and pouring down upon the earth itself, healing this earth, going into the earth and healing it. If we can see this, if all of us can see this, this combined energy is incredibly powerful. So it does, is it loves us. It is the divine givingness of the universe. And what that means is that whatever it is we deeply believe, it just says yes to. Going to give us everything we need, just like we're little spoiled children. We can have it all. And it's not that we're sitting around asking for war, asking for poverty, asking for health, or rather asking for illness. We're not doing that. But the thing is, if we, in our deepest belief systems, believe that bad things are going to happen, then God, the universe, this intelligence says, fine, I'll give you that. And so we need to look at life like a menu. You know, let's look at life as a menu of really good things, wonderful things. And we can just order up, order what we want. And the thing is that as we commit to training our minds, as we really deeply commit to this teaching, then things are going to unfold for us much more quickly than they have before. And as we stay positive, they're going to happen in a positive way. And we're going to be creating positive things in our lives. If you have a Science of Mind textbook, I really encourage you to read the first four chapters. Now, the first chapter is, the languaging is a little bit, it's Victorian, and it takes some doing to read it through if you haven't been looking at it for a while. But after that, it gets really easy. And so I really encourage you to reread those first four chapters because they're really a synthesis of the entire teaching and practice it. And when you do that, you're going to notice such a difference in your lives. And if you don't have a Science of Mind textbook and you want one, let me know and I'll see that you get one. I know we have some in our storage cupboard at our physical facility, and I can go down and get some and deliver them to you. You can order them online through Amazon. It's just called The Science of Mind by Ernest Holmes. And also, right at the almost near the front of the book, there are daily readings that are recommended. And they're not very long. Rachel was reminding me of this the other day. the first one the first one is the first meditation that is in the book, which is absolutely beautiful. You know, come and I will heal you. And I think that it's laid out in a way that we get to read some of the lovely stuff and some of the easier things to understand at first, because it's all, it moves all over the textbook. And then as it becomes deeper, we understand more easily what's in it. So I really, really encourage that. You know, we're not praying for awful things to happen anywhere. All of us want something better in life and something better on this planet. And we want this planet healed as well. We want this environment healed. And so knowing that we have this power, we have to believe this power in our minds. Do we believe it? You know, that's the place to get to believe it beyond any doubt that all this is possible. Believe that you have in you the same power that was in Jesus and Gandhi and Mother Teresa and all of the saints who performed miracles. Miracles are a commonplace thing in our teaching. They're natural. When we really, really use our trained minds, and we need to understand that pure love is more powerful than anything. More powerful than anything we can think of. You know, if ever we need to forgive somebody, if we're upset about anything, the most powerful way of letting that go, of releasing it, is just to sit down in a chair in meditation and to ask the beloved to love that person or to love that situation through you, through me. Excuse me. Move that love through me to that person. Move that love through me to all of the world. And after a while, and sometimes it takes a long time if we're really upset, but after a while, it starts to really, really make a difference. I've had this happen repeatedly in my life. Please love that person through me, and love me through that person. This is the love of God pouring through me, pouring through the other person. And there comes a moment of complete release, a moment of total love for that other person. And it's reflected back to us. This is the love that casts out all fear, that casts out what we call evil, that casts out doubt. Let us remember that as we write a new story for our lives, as we fall in love with life, as we have gratitude for life, fall in love with God. Now, remember, we have a direct telephone line to God with unlimited minutes. There's nothing to restrict us, nothing at all to ever restrict us from being in the presence, from feeling this presence within. We just are the ones who keep it away from us because we get so tied up in all of the complicated thoughts when it can be so simple. And so, you know, let us think more about that simplicity. The riddle of simplicity. Why do we have to make things so complicated? We simply don't. You know, to the degree that we embrace the power of God, we have the ability to manifest and become more God-like. That's what this is really about. We have the presence within us. Jesus was the example of who we can all be. And so we become more God-like as we embrace the power. As we go to a higher place, you know, Ernest Holmes was fond of saying, on high. I love that, you know, or the most high. Let us think the most high thoughts. Let us go to the most high places with our thoughts. That's where all of the inspiration comes from, the inspiration for what we want to write, whether it's a book, whether it's music, it's poetry, science, whatever it is that we would like to create scientifically. You know, every amazing idea has come from source. You know, how many times have we heard of a scientist who has created something that's spectacular, and scientists have been looking at it for years trying to do it, and all of a sudden, after following the pattern that others have followed for years, a scientist gets an original idea, it's like, well, what if we didn't do it that way at all? What if we did it this way? And all of a sudden, it happens. It's that divine inspiration, and we need to quiet our minds to allow it to flow through us, whatever it is that we want to create. Quiet our minds so that we can go into the simplicity. And when we do, we can hear the words of God coming through us. We can hear the messages. Just remember, the universe loves you more than anything that you can comprehend, more than your mother loved you, more than your greatest loved ones love you, because the love is absolutely unconditional and it is so pure. We need to just tune into our heart centers. You know, the place where the higher mind and the soul connect with God, with the source. That's the place where the manifestation begins, when we really feel that power. And I said, you know, when we go into the silence, we hear, you know, we will hear voices or we'll get a message of some kind. I'm not sure if you can see this. I'm going to share it with you. My daughter, Kendall, suddenly became an artist. She had never drawn anything in her life. And she's been painting amazing paintings. Some of them are very realistic and some of them are more impressionistic. And she sent me a picture for my birthday of an angel. And I'm just going to reach for it. And I'm not sure if you can see this or not, but I think you can. Anyway, she's wonderful. And when I received it, it was as if she was talking to me. And it was so strange. And I heard this voice say, "Call me Lavinia." Now, that's a name that you will hardly ever hear uttered from my mouth. It happens to be my middle name, and I hated it from childhood. But here's this angel saying, "Call me Lavinia." And all of a sudden, it sounded so beautiful. And I thought, well, okay, I've never had a painting ask me to call her anything before, but this is Lavinia. And I hung her up in the living room. And as I kept walking by, it was not the, I kept hearing this voice, "Not the right place, not the right place, not the right place." So I was thinking, well, where? And it was a specific place in my office. I had to move other things around on the wall to hang that painting there. And I thought, you know, isn't it wonderful? My name was my grandmother's name. And I thought, well, maybe I'm channeling, or maybe she's channeling my grandmother. I don't know. But the thing is, that it's there. And I was remembering Jane Houston telling people that if they wanted to be inspired, to hang a picture on the wall next to their computer or next to where they're meditating or writing or whatever, and to ask the person in that picture what it is they should be doing. And I remember when Hillary Clinton was writing It Takes a Village, Jane Houston asked her who she most admired in history. And she said, Eleanor Roosevelt. And she said, take a picture of Eleanor Roosevelt and put it on the wall and then ask her what you should write. And I thought, oh man, I'm going to talk to this angel and ask her what I should be doing in the next little while. She seems to have a massive power to her. And I called Kendall and told her about this, and she laughed and she said, you know, Mom, I was going to name her for you. And then I thought, nope, that's something you need to do for yourself. Anyway, it's something that I really treasure, and I don't know what messages I'm going to get, but the first couple were really actually kind of funny and fun. And, you know, everything is possible. Let us be open to that idea that absolutely everything is possible. Tune into your heart. Absolutely tune into it. Feel the love of God. Feel the compassion. You know, listen to the truth and the intelligence that is there. The memories that are there, take the good ones and dwell on the good, dwell on the beautiful, dwell on all of those things. Perfect life, perfect love is so simple. It doesn't have to be complicated. You know, as Emerson said, just get your bloated nothingness out of the way. Accept perfection and allow the miracles to unfold, and they will. And so it is. And so I want to thank you all for being here today. I want to thank you for your generosity. Some of you are going on PayPal and sending your donations to us. And some of you are sending them by e-transfer. Some of you are sending checks. We really, really appreciate this because it's what really keeps us afloat during these challenging times. And it's what keeps our center healthy and growing. And I'm so happy to say that during this time, during this pandemic, you know, this is now the second time we've been closed down, we are continuing to do well. And it's because of people like you. It's because of your great and generous hearts. It's because you know that all of the good that you do, all of the volunteer work, all of the gifts of time, of talent, of the financial gifts, all of those things are what make our center a wonderful community. And we are growing, and it's going to be wonderful when we're all back together again. So I thank you, and I bless you. And I would now like to invite a closing treatment from Reverend Rachel.
Thank you, Carrie. Can everybody hear me? Yes? Okay. The all-seeing eye. The eye of the spirit cannot be dimmed, neither can it be limited in its ability to see. My eyes are the vision of my indwelling. Lord, they are the windows of my inner spirit and are always open to the vision of truth. I see with the vision of the spirit, and this sight cannot be weakened nor lost. It is forever effective. My word, which I now speak, is the law of perfect sight. My eyes are opened and I see. Spirit sees through me, and may Spirit see through all of us throughout our coming week and forever on. And so it is.
And so it is. Thank you so much, Rachel. Excuse me. I bless you all. Have an absolutely wonderful week, wonderful rest of your day in that beautiful sunshine out there. I hope you're able to get out into it. And if any of you have any questions or need to speak to me about anything, just stay on the line after others log off, and I'm happy to have a chat with you.